Okay, as he said, let's have a coffee break until 10:15, and we will be hearing from our first keynote, Professor T.C. Pong from Hong Kong. Thank you very much. Asia-Pacific MOOC Stakeholder Summit. Now we are about to start our track number one, which is Subject and Program Level, as organized by Thailand Cyber University and Thai MOOC. We will start with our keynote speaker, and please allow me to give a brief introduction of our keynote. If I have to give full introduction, it will take me about 2 to 3 days, because he is such a prominent speaker. We're going to have a presentation by Professor Dr. Ting-Chuen Pong, or we call him Professor T.C. Pong, from Hong Kong. Professor Pong received a PhD from Virginia Polytech Institute and State University. He is now Director of Center for Engineering Education Innovation. He is also Professor of Computer Science and Engineering, also Senior Advisor to the Provost, teaching innovation and e-learning. So please give him a warm welcome. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for the introduction. And distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great opportunity for me to have the opportunity to share with you some experience related to evidence-based blended learning using MOOCs. By the way, this is the HKUST campus. I would say this is very beautiful. If you have not visited us, you're all welcome to visit our campus. Now, here is an overview of my talk. I'll first give a brief introduction to the pedagogical as well as technological trends in education. And then I'll talk about HKUST's MOOC and blended learning initiative and share with you some innovations in using blended learning and also MOOCs before I conclude. I'll first give the introduction to the trends and development in education. With a better understanding of the learning process, education has gone through a paradigm shift from teacher-centered to learner-centered pedagogy. And there's also a shift of focus to learning outcome and the mastery of the subject rather than just the content to be delivered. These changes has led to increasing emphasis on active and collaborative learning. On the technology side, the advances in internet and mobile technology, which provide the pervasive access to high quality digital content and allow us to learn anywhere, anytime using mobile devices. Research in big data and knowledge mining has allowed us to perform learning analytics so that we will better understand how students learn and how to enhance teaching by our teachers. Availability of augmented and virtual reality tools would create more stimulating learning environment that support active and collaborative learning. The convergence of these pedagogical and technological developments has led to the replacement of traditional lecture-style teaching by the new approaches, including blended learning, flipped classroom, and MOOCs. Well, I'm sure that you know what is a MOOC now, so I would not go through the details of each of these terms. But all you know that lecture-style teaching has been criticized as not very effective because it's using a passive, one-size-fits-all style of teaching. This criticism of lecture-style teaching can be summarized very well by a quote attributed to Mark Twain over 150 years ago, which says, college is a place where professors' natural notes go straight to the students' natural notes without passing through the brains of either. I think this is still quite true nowadays. So how can we make teaching and learning more effective? Perhaps we can go back even further. Over 2,000 years ago, one can find in the writing of a Chinese philosopher, Shunji. Well, if you can read the Chinese, then you can probably understand this, but if not, here is the English translation, which says, tell me, I'll forget. Show me, and I'll remember. Most importantly, it's involving the learner in the learning process that would make them truly understand. So there's a lot of study showing that active learning can improve the performance in different metrics, including attendance, engagement, and most importantly, the learning outcome, as published in the Science magazine here. Now, there are different approaches to active learning. One of the approaches that have gained popularity recently is the flipped classroom approach. The idea of the flipped classroom approach is basically to invert the traditional teaching approach. Well, all we know that the traditional approach to teaching is to start teaching in the classroom and then would assign homework to the students later on. Like the picture here, which depicts the classroom at the University of Bologna over 700 years ago. And you can see that the classroom setting is very much similar to many of the classrooms nowadays. You have the podium with the lecturers standing behind the podium or sitting, and then you have rows and rows of students or learners like what we have here. And you can see that you have the students taking a nap here, and you have the students chatting at the back. Actually, the instructor, those days is more lucky because nowadays you know that when you teach, the students are often distracted by the smartphone or tablets, right? So after the lecture, when the students return home to work on the homework, when they get stuck in certain problem, they have no one to seek help. So the idea of the flipped classroom is this process by starting teaching at home. Students can just watch the recorded lecture. The advantage of doing that is that they can really learn at their own pace, right? They can stop the video if they want to think about certain concept. They can rewind it. Or they can fast forward if they already know you have already acquired the knowledge. So after the students finish the online lecture videos, well, they could also actually interact with their peers through some online chat room like WhatsApp or Facebook. When the students come to class, instead of repeating the lecture, the focus would be on the high quality interaction between the teacher and the students, as well as among the students. You know, peer instruction has proven to be a very effective way of delivering both teaching and learning. And students can learn from each other. The teacher can pay more attention to those who really need it. So this is a kind of blended learning approach that combines face-to-face as well as online delivery of teaching using mixed mode of teaching. Now, if you look at MOOCs, well, you all know that MOOC is a kind of online course for a large number of learners, could be thousands or even hundreds of thousands. What is the difference between just watching a YouTube video or even TED Talk? Many of you have probably watched the TED Talk, which is very stimulating, but it's still a very one-way delivery, right? You watch the video for half an hour, and this study actually showed that this kind of learning would not allow the learner to retain the information. After 9 months or 6 months, This study is showing that 90% of the content would not be retained by the learners. So the difference between a MOOC and just a YouTube video and TED Talk is that there will be still some interaction. There could be online quizzes, and the videos are usually chunked to no more than 10 minutes, so that there could be activities being introduced in between. Currently, the MOOC platforms have very limited interaction, but there's a lot of development now to try to introduce more interaction in the MOOC platform, both interacting with the video, for example, by doing the annotation, bookmarking, and so on. There could also be interaction among the learner online. Now, another very important aspect of MOOC platform is that it would collect all the learning activities of the students, so that learning analytics could be performed. That would allow us to better understand how students learn and how teachers can improve the teaching and learning. So I'll go into a little more detail about this aspect of learning analytics later on. Now, as you all know, MOOC started in the US in 2012. The two main platforms are Coursera and EdX. And well, here, you probably know that there are multiple national platforms now, especially there's a JMOOC in Japan and KMOOC in Korea. In Hong Kong, we recently also developed a Hong Kong MOOC. Now, as you know, as MOOC gain popularity, the appetite of the learner is not just restricted to the individual courses. They would like to take more advanced courses. Recognizing this demand, the MOOC platforms have introduced the so-called massive open online programs. EdX introduced something called the X series in 2013. And then Coursera also introduced the specialization a few months later. So these are basically a series of related courses. And these are actually very successful. And just about a year ago, MIT introduced the program called MicroMasters, which is like half of a full-time master. They would allow the students to complete half of a master program fully online. If they finish the program and obtain the MicroMaster qualification, then they can apply to MIT for the on-campus full master program for half the time and half the course. So this is very attractive. And many universities now are trying to implement this kind of program. Well, a natural extension of MOOC, M-O-O-P, would be MOOD, M-O-O-D, Massive Open Online Degrees. And Georgia Tech is the first university implemented such of a MOOD. It's a full degree. Student would conduct, the teacher conduct all the teaching and learning online. And this is also very attractive and very successful. I want also to share with you a very interesting news about these, one of the courses offered through this online degree program. A few months ago, if you track the news about MOOCs, there's a news coverage about this robot TA. What happened is that since there are a large number of students from around the world, they need to provide teaching support for the students. So the course instructor assigned 10 TAs. One of them is actually a robot TA. But the instructor did not tell the students that there's actually a robot TA. Okay, it's only towards the end of the semester when the instructor announced that this particular person, not person, the account is a robot TA. Surprisingly, most students found that the robot TA is the best TA among the 10. Actually, this is not too surprising because robots don't need to sleep, right? So they can provide 27 surveys. And also, it would only answer the questions that it really understands. So it will always provide the right answer. If it has doubt about the answer to the question, it will leave it to the human TA. Once the human TA provided the answer, the robot could learn. Next time, if a similar question is being posted, then it could provide the right answer. So you can see that because of MOOC, because of the learning analytics, a lot of the development would be based on a lot of AI research, like here's a lot of machine learning methodology being developed here. Now, HKUST actually was the first university from Asia to join the MOOC movement. We joined Coursera in 2012. A few months later, we also joined EdX. So far, we have offered around 26 books, which attracted over 1 million learners from around the world. We are also pleased to see that some of our courses are also very popular. For example, last year in 2016, Ethics listed the 10 most popular courses. And you can see that one of them is from HKUST, the Java programming course. The course actually is offered by me. And you can see that there are courses from Berkeley, MIT, and then the Harvard course is ranked number one. Also on Coursera, our specialization, this is a specialization on full stack web development, is also very successful. It's listed as one of the top 10 computer science specialization last year on Coursera. Now, what's also interesting is that originally books are free, right? But we did not anticipate generate any revenue from these books, but the specialization here actually have generated over $2 million in just about 18 months. All right, so we actually have to deal with the difficult issue of how to distribute the revenue among the instructors and with the institution. But that's not our objective. When we started MOOC, we never thought about generating revenue. But if you have a good MOOC, it could also generate very significant revenue. Not only that, it will generate revenue, but if you look at this interview with Rick Nevin, is the president of Coursera.
Employers need to retrain people these days. I mean, we have jobs are changing so fast, work requirements change, and so companies see the need to do more rigorous training and deeper training. For example, Bank of New York Mellon is one of the pioneer customers of our Coursera for Business product, and what they're doing is taking a set of courses on full-stack web development developed by Hong Kong University of Science and Technology, and they're using it to onboard all their new software developers. It's just going to be part of their orientation.
So nowadays, there's a lot of B2B arrangement. So the MOOC platform will arrange with different multinational companies. So example here, thousands of employees from BNY Mellon taking our full stack web development specialization. We are also offering our own MOOCs to our alumni. Last year, we rolled out a pilot program. Over 1,000 of our alumni are taking these our own MOOCs. Okay, so again, we want to emphasize that continued professional development is also very important. And MOOC can play a very important role in that area. Now, this the course that I offer, I started this in 2014. And you can see that there's a very diverse student population from over 180 countries. Most of the students are from the United States, but quite surprisingly, a large percentage of the students are from India. So there's a lot of interest on MOOC from the developing countries. And then you can also see that the education background, although most of the students have already a college degree, but still a large number of the students are still in primary or even and secondary school. We actually try to analyze the performance of these students. And surprisingly, we found that of the top performers, these are students who all get almost perfect in all the assignments. A lot of them are actually not even high school students, just junior high students, and they're from India and then from Poland. So you can see that MOOC could also be a very good recruitment tool for outreaching to students from around the world. I talk about learning analytics, but the data collected from the MOOC platform is not very meaningful, just the raw data themselves. So we have to develop tools for visualizing and analyzing those data. So one tool that we developed is called a VisBook.
VisBook is a learning analytic tool for visualizing the data collected from MOOC platforms. A lecture video can be selected for carrying out the analysis. You'll find three graphs under the video. A graph at the bottom of the window represents the different mouse events, namely play, pause, seek, rate change, stored, and error. This is called a stack graph. One can move the cursor along the graph to find out the frequency of different mouse events entered by the users. Since six can go forward or backward, they are further represented in two separate graphs. The orange strips here shows the forward seek event. Each line in the graph represents the starting and ending position of a forward seek. The blue strip below it shows the backward seek events. The backward seek events are of particular interest. Let's switch to another lecture video. This lecture compares the education systems between China and the West. One can easily see that there's an obvious...
Sorry.
This book is a learning analytic tool. This book is a learning analytic tool for visualizing the data collected from MOOC platforms. A lecture video can be selected for carrying out the analysis. This book is a learning analytic tool for visualizing the data collected from MOOC platforms. A lecture video can be selected for carrying out the analysis. You'll find three graphs under the video. A graph at the bottom of the window. This book is a learning analytic tool for visualizing the. This book is a learning analytic tool for visualizing the data collected.
Okay, I'll just skip that. But what I want to point out is that this graph here gives you a lot of information on how the students are watching the video. All right, you can see that there are some peaks here, right? And then some students are actually going from the beginning to the end of the video without actually watching anything, because they may know the material already. But what's important is that you see a lot of this backward seek, rewinding the video. The intention of rewinding a video is very clear. They want to watch that part of the video again. Perhaps the concept was not explained too clearly. And then we can use that kind of information to focus on the in-class discussion. All right. So now, in addition to analyzing where the students are from, here we also have a way, for example, to try to analyze, say, the different learning activities for different student groups. So here you have the age group of students from 20 to 30. These are the activities, and then these are the activities for students for a different age group. Of course, you can also analyze that based on the education background, students with the degree, students who are in high school and primary school. Right? So this is very useful to try to look at how different group of students are studying. Another very important aspect is to analyze the discussion forum. So we use social network analysis to do the analysis.
Another feature offered by this analytic tool is for the discussion forum. By clicking on social network under forum, we can visualize how students interact with each other through their discussion postings. Each student is represented in the network by two attributes. The first is his performance in the course, which is color-coded in red if the student performs well, or green otherwise. The second is on how active is the student. An active student is represented by a larger circle, while an inactive student by a smaller one. We can look at the interactivities of individual students by moving the mouse around. For example, this is a very active student who also performed well, as indicated by the size of the circle and the red color. You can see that he or she interacted mostly with other high-performing students, as indicated by the red color. Let's look at another student who didn't perform as well, as indicated by the green color. Interestingly, he or she interacted mostly with students who also didn't do too well. Perhaps the instructor could step in to provide some help.
Okay, so you can see that the analysis could be done on just the video, the clickstream data, or even on the unstructured data like the discussion forum. Now, how can we actually make use of it? So after we offer the MOOC, we try to use the feedback from the students to improve the delivery of the same course on campus using blended learning. So as an example, one concept we introduce in computer programming is called program abstraction, right? Which is quite abstract. It's difficult for the beginner programmer to understand. The idea of abstraction is basically to focus more on the what than the how, right? But because it's difficult to understand, we often would use examples to further explain the concept. Here,
one can come up with other daily life examples using abstraction. In driving a car, when we step on the gas pedal, the car is supposed to accelerate. And when we step on the brake, it is supposed to slow down. But we don't really care the mechanics behind how they work.
Now, you can see that after I have given the example, students still have a lot of doubt. You can see a lot of rewind there. They try to understand the concept. So I provide them with another example by, say here, I talk about when you go to a lift, escalator, when you push a button, let's say 11 to come up here, you know the what is to get to a certain floor. But the how, in terms of electronics, the mechanics behind the implementation of the button, you don't need to know, right? So I thought that's a very good example. But still, a lot of students pose further questions. So I asked the students themselves, how about if you provide the examples yourself? And the students are actually very enthusiastic. One example being posed is that, think about Google search engine. When you search for something, the what is very clear. But the how, the algorithm behind Google search, you don't need to know. After the explanation, after the example was posted, the students put down, I get it, thanks. Nice explanation, I get it. Nicely said. Very nice example. This keep going on with a lot of these places. I am actually a bit jealous because I seldom received these places before. So you can see that the students themselves are contributing to teaching and learning. So the example here, the next time I teach, I actually use this example and the students really like it. All right, so you can see that the learning analytics, the information collected from the student feedback is very useful for enhancing teaching and learning, both on the MOOC as well as on campus. Well, we have now implemented the learning analytics tools on this Hong Kong MOOC platform, which is connecting all the university together with the secondary school, and later on we'll make this accessible to other countries. And this is the website, if you are interested. It's a platform sponsored by the government in Hong Kong. Now, I want to also talk about some innovative approaches on using MOOCs for delivering blended learning courses on campus. But you know the flipped classroom approach is synchronized in the sense that after you deliver the video for one class, then you will meet face-to-face to further explain the particular concept. The idea of the asynchronous flip is to allow the students to finish the entire MOOC. That means they have already acquired the knowledge about a particular course before they meet face-to-face. So it's asynchronous. Now, we have actually run a pilot by allowing the students to finish all the MOOC, and then we will run an assessment to make sure that they are the actual person participating in the activities, because when everything is done online, you don't know who's helping the students. So we have an assessment. If they pass the assessment, then the student will be enrolled in a two to three week face-to-face class. After that, at the end, they will take an examination. If they pass the examination, they'll earn credit for the course. All right? And these are some of the, say, activities that we actually run in class to reinforce the concept that we deliver in the MOOC by having a lot of these in-class activities. This is a sorting algorithm that we demonstrate in class. And then the feedback from the students actually is very positive. You can see that most of the scores are over 90 out of 100. And we see that this could be a model for expanding the international student exchange program, because instead of having the student to spend the entire semester in a foreign country, they can just spend the summer. And there are other advantages that I would not mention here. Another way for using this kind of model is for outreaching to the secondary school students. And we are already doing that. Now, in addition to delivering MOOC on traditional courses, we are now also to try to develop a project-based MOOC, right? Because experiential learning is also very important. So we have developed a MOOC on engineering approach for building airship. The idea is that we would introduce the fundamental concepts online. In building an airship, the fundamental concepts would be the mechanical parts, how to control the motor, how to generate enough force to lift the airship. So it's covered in the module here. There's also the Android app module for actually using the mobile phone to control the airship. And then the electronic part would be on the the controller using Arduino. So we put all these online. After the students acquire the concept, then we actually have the face-to-face section to provide explanation. But this could also be done online. And then at the end, the student would come in to build the airship. And you can see that at the end, there's a competition. This is the participation in the competition. And you can actually see that. So this is the grand prize, and the students have picked it up. And you can see that the students using the mobile phone, that they have the Android app that they've developed. Excited. And then there are also different tasks. They race to try to lock down this box here. All right, so these have been delivered first online. Okay, and then we have the face-to-face, blended learning, to really help the students to learn and be creative with the experiential learning approach also. Now, I just, before I end, I want to also mention that there's a lot of innovative approaches nowadays. One model is called the maneuver model. Anyone heard of maneuver? Maneuver, in the past 2 years, admitted students with an acceptance rate even lower than Harvard, the Ivy League universities. The aim really is to make Ivy League universities obsolete. All right? So, but then everything, so you can see that the college startup has a 1.9% acceptance rate. The way, well, this is the founder and CEO of Maneuver, and we actually invited him to give a talk at HKUST just last week. All right, so I'll play a short video to illustrate to you what kind of approach they are using. They live in 7 different countries.
There's not a single moment in class where you can actually doze off and daydream, where every single moment you are participating in the learning process.
We've hit on something really new, which we're calling fully active learning, where everyone is engaged and everyone is involved. So what we're trying to do is have each session be fully active learning.
Think of the fanciest version of Google Hangouts or Skype, designed to be a classroom. That's what it is.
It's very different than a traditional classroom, but in a way it's what a traditional classroom distilled down to its purest form, I feel like, would look like.
You are not a passive recipient of your education, you're actually active in it. You are debating and challenging your teacher and your peers.
So instead of delivering the classes in a classroom setting, the students learn from the MOOCs. All right, after they learn from the MOOCs, then they will participate in this kind of online interaction. Everything is done online. There's no face-to-face instruction by the teachers. All right, and it's turned out to be very effective. The students have done very well. And some of the students, after 1 year, they already got offer from top companies like Google and Facebook. All right, so, and well, here, I just want to, because of time, I just want to summary. Summarize what we are using MOOC for. We basically use MOOC as a catalyst for enhancing the learning experience of students, not only from online, but also for face-to-face, for on-campus teaching delivery. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor T.C. Pong, for a very insightful presentation. I'm sure we all enjoy it. We have about 5 minutes. Anyone would like to ask questions or any comments, please? Okay. One moment, please. We bring microphone to you.
Thank you, Professor. I'm Aliani Ismail from Malaysia. I just would like to get more information on the mechanisms for blended learning for your own in-campus students. Mm-hmm. Do you replace a face-to-face session with blended learning, or you still maintain the face-to-face hours, yeah, but use blended learning to support your classes, face-to-face classes?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because we have to worry about the workload of the students. Okay, so the face-to-face meeting is very important. But then because they have already learned the material from online, you can cut down the duration of the face-to-face session. We actually have established policy in the university to provide guidelines to the instructor. So currently, the face-to-face part would be at least 60%. Of the originally scheduled time hours. All right, so basically the student would watch the video lecture online. When they come to class, there would not be a repeat of the video. We will look at that. The system that we develop would provide just-in-time feedback to the instructor. So every class, we know how students watch the video and how they did in the online quizzes. So we know what topic to focus on, what concept to focus on. So we can also cut down the actually face-to-face meeting time with the students. But it's high, a lot more high-quality face-to-face interaction rather than just a one-way delivery like the lecture. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
anymore. Oh,
yeah.
Kun Wesley,
that was fantastic. Thank you again, TC Pong. I feel like all of us might be a bit intimidated. I'm intimidated. I think that so many steps to get to that point. Can you tell us how you get started? Like, if I'm doing 5% blended learning, eventually that becomes a MOOC, but can you give us an advice on where to begin to build up to the levels that you're achieving? It's just remarkable, but it seems like quite an elaborate process to put this all together at this level.
Well, as you mentioned, everyone have less than 5 years of experience. So we started this around 4 years ago. Mm. I myself actually won the course as a blended learning course first before developing MOOC. Mm. So I would receive feedback from the on-campus student on the video and also the online quizzes before I actually spent the whole summer. In the summer of 2014, I've never worked so hard before in the summer for my 30 plus year of as a teacher. So it's a lot of work, okay? But then to receive feedback is very important. And then this is a continuing process. Every time we receive feedback from the student, one thing nice about the design of the MOOC is very modular. Mm. You don't have to revamp the entire thing, right? You just change one module at a time. All right, and then so it would take, I would say, the 1 year for me to start from the development of the blended learning modules to the full MOOC course. That, for example, for the first time when I offered the Java programming, it was a 10-week course. It was too long, right? A lot of students drop out after 4 to 5 weeks. So I split it up into two parts. Now it's two parts of Java programming. Each one is 5 weeks. So this continued development process is very important. Mm. And it's still ongoing. So about the different stages, I would say the feedback from both on-campus students as well as the online students, the MOOC students, are both very important. Yeah. And for the university as a whole, we learn also it's a steep learning curve. All right, so on the video production, instructional design is also very important. So we basically have three teams. The instructional design team, because you have to chunk the video in a way that you can introduce the proper interaction in between videos. And then, of course, the video production. What we find is that you don't have to be really very elaborate. Mm. Say for my course, everything is done by myself. It's in a DIY, do-it-yourself video recording room. Okay, so I think it's the content that's important, because they're not watching a video. I mean, they're not watching a movie, right? They're learning. So I think it's the content is still most important.
Thank you so much. And one question from MC, please. You mentioned about the machine feedback, the automatic feedback. Would that be available in more than one language? Now it is in English or?
Well, it's in English, but now, because it attracted so much attention with deep learner from around the world, some countries actually pay the license to us to translate some of the courses into different languages. Yeah, for example, Russia actually is now offering the course. So basically, they do the translation, and Saudi Arabia, they translate the course into Arabic. So, and then China. So I think once you have the content, the different countries can make the translation. In fact, what you'll find is that a lot of the students are not just students, they are teachers themselves. All right, because they want to find out how the other instructors are teaching the same subject. Right, I also myself would take a look at how other people are teaching Java. Although mine is the first one, but now there are a few others. So I will look at how others did it, and then try to improve it. Yeah.
Wow. So I'm sure we're all impressed by his talk. So please join me to give him a big thank you. Thank you so much, Professor T.C. Pong.